Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Spurs Fan Forum. This is amazing. Very good. Now, I think it's probably about time to bring on some incredible individuals onto this stage. Let us start with the captain of Tottenham Hotspur's women's team, Bethany England. Then also, I'm going to introduce everyone at the same time. Then what we're going to have come on is the manager of the women's team, Robert Vilahamn. Then the chairman of Tottenham Hotspur, Daniel Levy. Then the manager of Tottenham Hotspur's men's team, Ange Postecoglou. And the captain of Tottenham Hotspur's men's team, Sonny. Wow. This is so good to be back here. This is so good. How are we all feeling? All good? Yes. Yeah. Yeah, so take your pictures. There you go. Let's do that. Let's take our pictures. Let's get them all done and then we'll get our phones put away. This doesn't feel weird, does it, at all? Spotlights and everyone. There you go. Waves. Yes. I want to start, Daniel, with your good self. It's been 6 years since you and I sat on a stage and did this, and in those 6 years, there's been some quite challenging times, and a lot of, well, this wasn't here 6 years ago. Can you just give us an analysis of those last 6 years, if possible, the kind of the challenges, the difficulties, but also the achievements that you're proud of?
I mean, firstly, it's hard to believe it's been 6 years since we were together, but in that 6 years, obviously opened the stadium, had a pandemic, we got into the final of the Champions League, unfortunately didn't win it, and then we're back here, got Ange. Lots of things have happened.
Lots of things have happened. Yeah. Your kind of assessment of how the club came out of the pandemic and the challenges that that faced for the club, because I know that you were on the record as saying that it cost this club so much more because of the amount of events that had to be cancelled.
I think people will never really appreciate how difficult it was for us. You know, we just opened a stadium. We had, at that time, and we still do have, more debt than any other club in Europe. Luckily, it was all long-term finance. But all of a sudden, we didn't have any income. And, you know, the whole financing of the stadium was predicated on having income, and it just stopped. And luckily for us, we were very highly regarded in the financial markets, and we managed to get some assistance from the Bank of England that enabled us to keep going. It was a very, very stressful period. And luckily, the institutions that originally helped us, they refinanced the debt and we repaid the Bank of England. But it was a cost of about £200 million.
I want to bring you on just a question, one of the questions that's submitted here, and I'm going to dot a few of those around throughout our conversation. This one's from Louis Stevenson. Louis? Yeah? There you go. Well done, Louis. This question's a really interesting one, Daniel. The club haven't got a partner yet for stadium naming rights, and the process is now into its fourth year since moving in. Do you feel that's a missed opportunity for revenue over that period? And had you secured a partner, would that money have not contributed to the club and therefore you wouldn't be putting up the cost of individual match day pricing, which has a direct impact on loyal supporters?
Well, there's a couple of questions there. So the process of...
We'd start with the light ones, yeah.
On the question of naming rights, it's quite a complicated process. Unfortunately for us, we got interrupted by COVID. You know, to do a naming rights deal, it's got to be probably a company that comes and visits the stadium, experiences it. So that interrupted the process. And then since then, you know, we've taken the decision that as much as we would like the right sponsor, it's really important for us to build our name globally. And all the events that we've had at this stadium is just enlarged the profile of this club. So for us, we want to find the right sponsor and the right sector and the right price. And in the meantime, unless we get that, we won't put a name on the stadium. We'd rather just have Tottenham Hotspur. In answer to the second question about pricing, you know, ticket pricing is an area that I know everyone's sensitive to, and so are we. You know, we haven't put up ticket pricing until recently, despite the fact that they've been fixed for over 4 years. That's as far as general admission ticket pricing is concerned. Season ticket pricing hasn't gone up. Premium pricing has gone up during the period. We're all facing increased costs. We've absorbed as much as we can. But you're right, you know, if we had other sources of income, maybe we wouldn't have had to do it. But, you know, we're in a highly competitive industry, and everything we do is to maximise the income to invest in the team.
And what is the kind of review process around that? Because fans, as you are well aware, have been very frustrated about that. And we can go on later on to talk about you listening to fans and Ange being part of that listening process. But what about reviewing those costs going forward?
So we've agreed with the FAB that we're going to do a long-term strategy paper on ticketing generally. It's not just about pricing, it's about access. It will involve away ticketing. It may get into things like membership. We're going to do a complete review and look at how we can improve things.
I firstly want to give a round of applause to Beth England, because she had surgery, hip surgery, 2 weeks ago and still made it here tonight. Now, Beth, an important question to ask you. Have you graduated with your law degree yet? Does your mum have a chance to have that certificate? She has, the two sisters have already graduated. You're the last. Have you graduated?
I have finished my degree, however, I've missed graduation for the past 2 years due to the Euros and the World Cup. So I'm still yet to do the hat and gown and the picture and put it on my mum's wall, so she's still waiting for it. But, yeah, I'm still trying to get that.
As excuses go, though...
Done it, but
it's incredible the impact you've had on Tottenham's women's team straight away. You know, you were adult and junior supporters player of the season, yeah. Right? Come on. Yeah. How does it feel to have joined Tottenham Hotspur?
It feels amazing. I mean, for me to have been given them awards last year, I was very surprised by that. Being the fact that I'd only been at the club in such a short period of time, I felt there was probably other players that maybe deserved it more. And although I'm the one that was scoring the goals, the rest of the team, it's not a one-man team, it's a full squad of players, whether you're starting, the subs, the people that aren't in the squad. So I was very humbled to have received those awards. And yeah, I feel like ever since I've been here, I know I came from everyone's rivals. So,
I'm glad you didn't say that.
Yeah,
name. No. So I say Voldemort in
no,
this
we
building.
Don't say, we don't say that name here, but yeah, no, I think obviously for me, I came in here to this football club. Everyone welcomed me with open arms, gave me the platform and the confidence that I needed to go out there and play my best football. And I know one thing you will get from me is goals, and that's what I gave this football club. And thankfully, we stayed up and we're ready to start a new season now and fight again.
Hear, hear. Absolutely. It was quite a surprise when you found out you'd won Adult and Junior Supporters Player of the Season, wasn't it?
Yeah, a big surprise. Like I say, there was players that have been here throughout the whole season that I felt truly deserved it. I picked up a few awards, actually, even the players playing. I'm like, I've been here 5 minutes. But, yeah, it's... like I say, I can't thank enough for the staff, the team and the environment I had around me, because without them making me enjoy football again, I would never have been able to put the performances I did week in, week out for this team. And it was very proud for me to receive those awards from the fans.
Brilliant. Talking of surprises, Sonny, how much notice were you given by Ange that you were going to be captain of Tottenham Hotspur?
Actually, that day I just noticed, you know, in that meeting, he just called my name. I was nervous moment in my life because I had to give a speech to the players, and then I would look at the back and the video, and I was just clapping in there like
yes.
20 times. So it was just weird, but I mean, being this huge club, being captain is looks such an honor. I'll do my best, and obviously the team is doing well. So, but I mean, that day was the biggest surprise. because I didn't expect, but also it was a special day for me.
Yeah. Captain. What have you learned from captain in your country that you bring as a captain to Tottenham Hotspur?
Look, I mean, I've been a national team captain since maybe 2018, after 2018 World Cup. So it's been it's long, long time being a captain. But obviously, I'm not the guy who is always talking. But I'm just trying to be a good example, you know. And obviously, I made a big mistake when. Also, I learned so many things since from 2018 when I was being captain for national team. Obviously, you see different things, you experience different things. But obviously, when you named captain in these huge clubs, it changed everything. You know, you have to bring your all the experience, what you got. You know, so. But look, what I said before, I just want to be a good example to from our players, from our fans. And from these clubs, so, which is for me very, very important. So, but being in the national team captain helped me a lot to be captain of this club. So yeah, I was still room to improvement as a captain, but the players doing amazing, amazing job for me doing that. My captain job, really, really easy.
Ange, why this? It's like the Beatles, Ange. Why the surprise? Why do it that way?
Part of leadership is how you deal with unexpected situations, mate. So, I think when you, because I think it's a massive responsibility and it's a big decision for my behalf. I thought it was a fairly easy decision. I kind of knew that Sonny would be a great fit, but. At the same time, I knew that, you know, when I did tell him knowing how he feels about this football club, I could sense that. And knowing how his teammates would respond to it, I knew it'd be overwhelmingly positive. I wanted him to feel it in that moment rather than sort of me telling him and an awkward silence between us because he couldn't hug me or do anything. So. You know, I just felt it was a moment that he should share with the people who were most important. That was the players, and I think, as I said, for me, it was a really easy decision.
Mm. Daniel, was it an easy decision to appoint Ange in the first place? Can you talk us a little bit through the interview process?
God, it feels like a lifetime ago now. it actually was very easy because Ange is, I would say, just a normal bloke. And it was wonderful to be able to have a conversation with him where we could talk about anything. And he was very direct and very honest. And I like someone that just tells me as it is. No one that plays games, no one that says one thing to me, says something else to somebody else.
Can't think who you're talking
about.
No,
I'm not talking about anyone in particular. Just a normal guy.
Yeah.
This club needed to go back to its roots. And
yes, yeah, yes.
Honestly, there was a lot of pressure on me to bring in somebody that was a big name, etc. And I just wanted somebody that understood our DNA, that would play attacking football, that would give young players a chance, that would believe in the academy, would build a relationship with the fans, understood, you know, the resources that we have and don't have as a club. And be part of a team. And Ange, I have to say, is a breath of fresh air.
Hear, hear. Yeah. Yeah. What was your first impression of Daniel?
Look, I think, first of all, I've got to say, Postecoglou is a pretty big name, you know?
Yeah.
But, you know, I think you go into these things always, you know, whenever I've sort of spoken to, you know, people who represent, the organisations you're potentially going to join. It's about trying to understand the person and trying to understand, you know, sort of his feelings about the football club and where they're at. Because I think with me, people have figured out I've... there's certain things that I have, you know, really strong beliefs about, and seeing whether there's a fit there. And, you know, since, you know, pretty much what Daniel said tonight, that he wanted this, what he wanted for this football club, in terms of the style, in terms of, you know, the environment, the young players, the connection with the fans, it's all stuff that resonated with me. So that was the most important thing for me, that I kind of got a clear understanding that what they were looking for, I knew I could deliver. And that's what you're looking for in that sort of discussion, because ultimately, you know, if it was if the discussion went a different way, as great an opportunity as this is, it's a fantastic football club. And since I've joined it, you realise just what a, you know, big, sort of well-resourced, and it's got fantastic supporters. For me, I wasn't just going to jump into the opportunity because of that. It needed to be a good fit, because otherwise it wouldn't work. You know, it'd be a sort of square peg in a round hole. It needed to
be
an alignment. Yeah, and I think there's a lot to that, you know. And
it's true.
So from my perspective, that was the main thing, you know, that after I had the discussion with Daniel, I thought, okay, well, you know, I didn't know which way they'd go, but if they did go with me, I felt really comfortable that I could sort of fulfil the kind of, you know, responsibilities that would have been bestowed upon me.
Robert, what are the challenges you coming from the, now do I say this right, Damel Svensken, is that right? The Swedish Women's League to the WSL, the differences?
I would say it's a lot bigger here. I mean, the clubs are having more fans. It's like, this is not the Swedish way. It will be like five people, perhaps. So it's more like, it's bigger. I think it's more competitive, and the potential is much higher as well. I mean, if you look at Tottenham and the brand we have here, we can be the best women team in the world. We cannot do that in Sweden. So I think, you know, the potential here is really cool.
Yeah.
Considering what last season was like, and Bethany, thank you for that. I think we all owe you a debt of gratitude for that. What have you set yourself as your targets for this season?
I mean, I think I was hired to make sure we play a certain style of football that the fans will like, and that's like similar to what Ange doing as well, right? So I think the best way to do that is to make sure we play attacking football and that kind of thing, but we also need to win games, because I don't think you will enjoy the games if we lose all the time. So it's like the mixture of playing better football but still find a way to win in this journey, right? So perhaps the first year will be hard to win the Women's Super League, but perhaps we can actually get there quite quickly and start playing good football and have the results, and then, you know, you're chasing that title.
That's great. Ange, I'd like just to ask you about, you know, going to watch South Melbourne with your dad, right? And seeing how he came alive in that atmosphere. And something I read about you, which I just thought was extraordinary, was thinking of your dad watching a team you manage. And what do you want? He's sadly not with us anymore, but what do you want him to see in teams that you manage?
Yeah, look, I mean, I guess I've spoken about this a lot, only because for me that's where, you know, hopefully people get a better understanding of, you know, what sort of makes me tick, is that football to me is more than just something that I've done sort of as a living or something that I'm passionate about. It's got a deeper connection for me, because it was the thing that sort of allowed me to connect with, you know, a father whose generation was very much about just working for your family and not much else. There wasn't, you know, there wasn't a lot of, you know, bedside chats and cuddles and giggling. It was, you know, he'd work hard and come home and sort of collapse on the couch and then be gone before I was up for school. And that was our relationship. But, yeah, there was a little window, you know, a two-hour window on a Sunday where we'd go watch our local football club, that he was a different man, you know. He'd abuse the referee, abuse the coach. he just came to life. And, you know, even as a young boy, it kind of, you know, dawned on me that, you know, if I wanted to get close to him, that this was it. You know, football was the conduit. And, yeah, that sort of stayed with me my whole life. And like I said, he's a man of his generation. He wasn't, you know, always wielding out the compliments to me. He was a pretty hard man. So, you know, even, you know, I think I've told the story a few times, we won the Asian Cup against Sonny.
yeah, we didn't want to sit you next to each other for that reason. But
Sonny scored in the last minute to equalise for Korea, and we had to go into extra time. And Sorry, Sonny, but I'm going to just talk about this a bit longer. We ended up winning in extra time, and we won the Asian Cup. And at the time, my dad wasn't well, so he didn't come up for the game. It was in Sydney. He lived in Melbourne, so I went down to Melbourne, and I took the medal and sort of went down and saw him and showed him the medal. And he goes, "Yeah, that's great, but if you'd had made a couple of substitutions earlier, you wouldn't have gone into extra time." So. So that was his kind of grudging approval of me, but that was a huge motivation for me, that I always wanted to please him, even as an adult, as a father myself. I still had this thing that I wanted to please him, and he just was not interested in any football other than teams that were exciting, and so I kind of have that seed in the back of my head where, if he was here and he was watching, what would he say? And like I said, he's a pretty hard taskmaster, so... from my perspective, it's always a good barometer. Keeps my feet on the ground, because I know that as chuffed as I am with myself sometimes, he'd probably give me a backhander about what I could do better.
Amazing. Sonny, it's the night before the Brentford game and you send James Maddison a text. You may have sent him a few, but I'm focusing on this one particular one. And it was about where you chose to huddle as a team. Can you just tell us about that text that you sent James Maddison?
Look, I was just thinking about it because it's. I just want to create something special connection, because I think because it felt a little bit distant us with the fans, with the players. Obviously, depending on the results as well. Especially last year, we had a tough year that obviously fan didn't expect. Also, the player didn't expect. So yeah, it was obviously first game of the season. So I just spoke to Madas and Kuti. And yeah, let's do the cuddle in front of our fans that make us a little bit closer. So the connection feels a little bit closer and you're closer to each other. So obviously 90 minutes or 100 minutes, you need the big support, because 90 minutes, obviously we want to dominate the game, but some minutes, some games, some part of game, we gonna have a suffer. But that moment we need big supporters, So that's why I thought, yeah, maybe it's a good idea, start of season, let's go together. Obviously on the pitch is our job, but whole genuine things in whole packages hold together, Even if you have a good time or bad time, so we have to stick together. So I think that's why I made the decision, and Mother's response straight away. So yeah, it's a good idea, let's do that. And Kuti, and still waiting his response. But fine. So then we were running down to the fans, and Kuti was looking at me. He was like, "What's going on here?" But it was all good. So and then yeah. But after that, everyone is just understanding what this means to the fans. So I think we get a good connection with each other. So I think we should keep this until end of season, because it's very, very important for the players and also for the fans.
Yes. Robert, can you tell me about your philosophy of team, how you get a team to believe in each other?
I think, like everywhere, you need to make sure that you feel that you can be yourself, right? So for me, it's more like to make sure that Bethany and the player who might be number 25 in the field also feel like they are a part of the team. So I try to, build an environment where you can be yourself and that you have a role, even if you are the captain or whatever, right? And if you don't really know how to get to the captain role or the starting 11, you can discuss with me, because I like to have the conversations and everything. So for me, when I played, I didn't really feel like I had those coaches who saw me or answered the questions to me. So I'm trying to be that coach now. And I know sometimes that it's hard to speak to the coach, right? So I'm trying to have a good staff members as well, so everybody know what we are trying to do and create. And I think if you come to the training ground, you can see that the whole Tottenham is this familiar club where everybody acting say hi to each other and everything. So it's a good match for me, because that's my leadership, basically, to make sure you treat everybody in a good way and make sure everybody want to be a part of the journey, right?
Indeed. Yeah. Ange, people often say it's about winning. That's what it's about. But just tell us about belief and how that actually trumps. Everyone wants to win.
Yeah, and it is. It is about winning. Ultimately, that's what we want to do. We want to win games of football. We want to bring success to the football club. That's the end game. But as you said, that's every football club in the world has that aim. It's how you get to that space, I guess. And you know, I've always felt that you know, you'll get to that, to be that kind of team that's consistently in a position to win things if you believe in something beyond just, you know, 3 points on the weekend. And different clubs, you know, have different ways of getting to that belief. But I think it is, it's a really important thing, because when it gets tough, I mean, you just have to look on the weekend, you know, we're obviously 1-0 down late in the game, but what got the boys to win was not that they wanted to win. Of course they wanted to win, but so did Sheffield United, was that the lads really believe in sort of the team we want to be and the way we want to play, and they stayed sort of calm and clear-headed through that process. And I was, you know, really pleased, obviously, that they got the rewards. Not because we won, because if we didn't win, and I know everyone would be disappointed, but I still saw that in them, that what drove them was their belief in saying, you know what, we'll play our football, you know. Don't worry about the opposition, don't worry about the game, the time, the minute, home, away, just focus on our football. And I think, for me, that's always been sort of the common denominator through my whole career, is to get the group, not just the players, the staff, to believe in something beyond just winning a game of football, to believe in a way of playing that will get us there. But at the end of the day, trust me, I want to win things. So that's all I'm interested in. I want to win trophies, I want to bring success. It's just, I believe there's a way to get there, and that is through having a real strong connection with something that goes beyond just the, you know, getting 3 points on the weekend.
Beth, just tell us about, because you were just made captain last week?
Yeah, I think so.
Last week. I mean, that's amazing. Yeah. How did you feel when you were handed that?
Yeah, again, God, there's, I don't know how many times I can say I'm honoured, to be honest, but I feel like royalty at this club now. But literally, for me, it's, yeah, my biggest achievement yet, I think. It's something that I'm new in. I've never captained, I mean, I've captained my school team, but that was a few years ago now. But yeah, I think
Tykes,
for me...
What was the club, Tykes?
Oh, Junior Tykes.
Junior Tykes. Yeah. Big up Junior Tykes.
But yeah, for me, I think I've been around a lot of great leaders, a lot of great people, and I've got good people around me to help me, because I know there's going to be times when I'm going to fail. I'm not going to get things right, and it's important to learn from those mistakes and make sure that they don't happen again. But for me, it's a case of making sure, again, as Robert touched on, is that everyone feels valued, has a voice, and feels comfortable within themselves, because we all know when we're all happy and we can express ourselves, that's when we play our best football. And that's what I want our team to show this year, is that we're not the same team as what we were last year. We're going to play some exciting football. We're going to get things wrong. Those results probably won't go our way at times, but I want to show that we're here to fight and that we're going to make a big impact on the women's game this year. And I can't wait to be at the forefront of that, leading this team when I get off these bloody crutches. But yeah, I can't wait. But yeah, for me, it's a huge, huge honour. And I hope between myself, Molly, Olga, my vice captains, and Robert, we can create an amazing environment to make sure that this women's team really push on this season and show everyone that we're not here just for the sake of being here, and that we mean business.
Does it lift you? Because sometimes it can be a lot of pressure to fill that role as a captain. Does it lift you, or is there also, while lifting you, an element of, okay, this is a big responsibility?
I think to an extent it does. However, for me, I think the biggest thing is that I don't want to change the person who I am. I don't want to become something just because of a bit of cotton on my arm. Like, I've always seen myself since I've been here as someone that people look up to and respect. And I think, like Sonny said, I think you just have to make sure that everyone is feeling safe in this environment, and that you're leading by example and being a good person and a good role model, because when one follows, they all follow suit. And I think it's about making everything as exemplary as possible, being a good captain, a good role model, so that everyone can come together as a collective, and we're all here for one aim, and that's to win football. And yeah, I think it's just exciting times, and for me, I love pressure. We had enough pressure last year, I think, to last a lifetime. So I think for me, it's something that I'll relish in and hopefully do a great job at.
Absolutely, absolutely. Sonny, you know, 21-22, golden boots, right? 22-23, perhaps not. Well, definitely not a golden boot, but just not to your usual high standards that you set for yourself. at that time, you can train and train and train, but about what's going on in your head, how did you cope with that part of it? How do you cope with that part of it?
Look, obviously it was tough year for myself and also for the team, because it was tougher because I expect more from me and the team is going to down, you know, like it's just not performing well. And then obviously I blame myself firstly because it is a big part of this this club. I played almost every single game. I started every single game and then I felt like I let the club down, I let the player down, so I let the manager down. It was really hard time, obviously, yeah, in a different reasons, pain, whatever, the play style or whatever, you know? We can talk about, sit down here all day and talking about from last year, but look, but this time, because I think it's made me even stronger, you know? Because I thought, look, I've been in the professional football maybe, started in Germany, what? 18 years now here, another nine season. So it's been a long, long journey. So I thought like, okay, now I'm experienced player. I faced all the different things and I faced a tough time. But last year was probably, I would say, the toughest season I ever faced. But also I learned the most, even I learned more than when I was 18, you know? So which is very, very surprised to me because I never expect that I'm going to learn something that make it stronger again, you know? So I think that's why I'm here, being again, coming to the next season. Name of this club, of the captain is again, another big step forward because I have tough time this and I can face this, I can make stronger. I can definitely make, it was tough moments, but definitely this part of my lifetime as a player, as a human being, I think definitely make me stronger.
Yeah, what a guy, what a guy. And a hat trick against Burnley doesn't, I mean, that's pretty good as well, isn't it?
Yeah, scoring goals is always good, especially it is tough game against Burnley, especially so, but I think when you look at these games, I think the performance, team performance was fantastic. I think everyone enjoyed it and obviously, you know what I don't feel comfortable is that obviously when you score, you get all the spotlight, but the way we play, I get the assist, I think all the teammates, even who played, even who was on the bench, who was not even involved, I think they should all get credit because the work we do whole week, it was fantastic. So I think we totally deserve it. So I think everyone should get spotlight because it was actually a fantastic performance from the team.
It really was. I think picking up on that theme, Daniel, it's quite interesting, as Sonny mentioned, about what you learn from setbacks. What did you learn from the two previous managers? What did you learn from that experience?
you may be surprised by my answer now, but I want to win just as much as everybody else. And the frustration... Yeah. The frustration of not winning and the pressure from maybe some players and from a large element of the fan base that, you know, we need to win, we need to spend money, we need to have a big manager, a big name. And it affected me. I had gone through a period where, you know, we'd almost won. You know, with Maritza, we went through some very, very good times. We didn't quite get there, but we came very close. And we had a change in strategy, and the strategy was let's bring in a trophy manager. And, you know, we did it twice. And look, you have to learn by the mistakes. They're great managers, but maybe not for this club. And for what we want to play a certain way. And if that means it has to take a little bit longer to win, maybe it's the right thing for us. And that's why, you know, bringing Ange in was, from my viewpoint, exactly the right decision.
I think the viewpoint of everyone in this room as well. So, Daniel, thank you for doing that. Thank you for doing that. Ange, why is it the case now that a coach is not someone who just tells players what to do?
The world's changed, mate. When I was growing up, if a coach told me to do something, I just did it. You know, we didn't question anything. We just had to sort of follow whatever instructions we were given. It was just a different, life was different. I just think, and I'm getting sort of further and further away from the generation I'm coaching, but that's why I've got young staff around me to bridge that gap. But you kind of need to understand that, young people growing up today have a much different sort of upbringing than I did or people of my generation, where, like I said, we pretty much followed blindly whatever we were told. Young people today have got a lot more exposure to a lot more information. They're a lot more inquisitive. They're a lot more challenging, and again, going back to belief, I think you need to give them a reason to do something rather than just tell them to do something. And the end game is still the same. It's, the coaches who were telling me to do something when I was young were doing it from a good place. They felt that was going to have a success. But their audience in us, we wouldn't question that. I think today you need to give young people something more than that. You need to give them, like I said, a reason to do what I believe will get us the success and to show them the benefits of it and to engage in a way that, they feel like they're part of the process rather than, sort of me just telling a room full of people what to do. So, and it's not easy because, again, I've been doing this for 27, 28 years, and when I first started, it was different. But the world's changed and you've got to stay kind of relevant in your messaging. And as I said, I think it's definitely a better way to do it because you feel like everyone feels, I mean, Robert spoke about it before, but everyone feels connected, everyone feels valued, everyone feels like they're contributing to something rather than just a manager sort of getting up there and, telling people what to do. Having said all that, they all do what I tell them to do anyway. So, I'll get there one way or another. But I do think it's important that, there is that engagement, but ultimately that's my role. I'm the one that has to take the responsibility because I'm the one that's making these decisions and I'm the one that's taking us. So I need to take responsibility. And I think people want that as well because, as much as you try and engage everyone, they need to also understand that if things don't work, it's on me. It's not on anyone else. I'm taking us down this direction and hopefully I get people to believe in that. But, the last thing you want to do is sort of engage people and then, if things don't go well, sort of throw them off the cliff. It's still my decision to go a certain way. It's just the way you sort of get that across to people.
Robert, can you just tell us about what you've learned from setbacks in your career? At Häcken, for instance.
Yeah, I mean, I think I'm learning from all my setbacks all the years, and I think I will continue to do that until I'm dying, right? I think that the most important thing is that you take that setback and reflect on it and take the next day that comes and make something good of it, right? So like Sonja told me, like the last season was you learn a lot, right? And of course, you shouldn't just be down. You should use that information that you got to take the next step. And I think when you dare to do that, you don't really are so scared to fail because you know that you will develop anyway, right? So it's more like, okay, you win or lose, but just make sure you take a better week next week and make sure you do a better game next week. And for the long run, you're gonna have a good result with that. So just make sure you don't get down too low when you lose and don't get too high when you win because you still need to develop, right? So it's something in between there.
Yeah, absolutely. Sonny, can you give us a sense of the atmosphere now with your teammates? What Ange has given you in that sense, that belief that he's talking about?
The changing room, or the clubs, or the stadium. I mean, the vibes is really, really positive. For example, today I had a doping after training, so even the guys that's coming and say, wow, they changed the vibe, So because last year they turn up and probably they're seeing us being down, So I think today they came and you say, yeah, the vibe is much better than last year and look really, really positive. And which is what we're looking for. Obviously, when you're positive, you play with the confidence and obviously you're performing well. So I think this is what we're looking for. And yeah, players definitely working hard, really, really hard, because the training session is really hard. So yeah, they play for winning. So they want to win. They want to give back something to our fans, because yeah, they know what this means, you know. So yeah, definitely the vibe is really, really good and positive, which is very, very good at the moment.
And what does Sonny bring to the team as captain? This is an awkward moment where he's going to speak about you there.
No, quite comfortable speaking. I mean, he's everyone knows he's a fantastic footballer, but he's just a brilliant human being, mate. And to me, that's, you know, you can be both. You know, sometimes people, you know, with footballers, you know, they sometimes it's self-inflicted by the footballer, but they sort of put him in a certain bracket. But he's just a fantastic human being, and I think for any sort of manager, when you're looking for leaders in a group and they're all different types, is, you know, firstly, you know, what kind of person are they? Are they going to reflect the values, you know, the behaviours that are really important to me when I'm setting up a team? And you know, even from afar, like even before I joined the club, and obviously, you know, I've known of Sonny for a long time because, you know, being from that part of the world myself, you know, working in Asia and the exposure I had to his standing in the community there. But even from afar, you can tell he was respected, because whether it was, you know, teammates or opponents, everyone spoke really highly of him. And I think he was the, you know, the perfect embodiment. And you know, you have to remember, we've got a really young group at the moment, really young group. You know, even in our starting 11, we've got guys who, you know, four or five who it's their first year in the Premier League, you know, 20, 21 years old. They've come into a massive football club. It's a big challenge for them, and it can be overwhelming depending on the dressing room you walk into. And I think the fact that, you know, Sonny, and credit to Matters as well, James Madison and Kuti Romero, that, you know, they've embraced that leadership role in just creating an environment where all the boys, irrespective of whether they've been here 2 months or they've been here 10 years, they feel really comfortable in there, you know, and that's because, you know, of the people who are the leaders, not necessarily the players, the people. And like I said, for me, I've done this a long time, and I've had a lot of success, but whenever I reflect on my career, it's always about the people I've shared it with more than the actual success, because the success brings you back to the people that you shared it with, whether that's players, coaches, fans, you know, people who are involved in the football club. And that's one of the greatest sort of gifts I have in my role, is that I get to share a space with, you know, people like Sonny.
Beth, what about, yeah, I mean, it's Sonny, right? It's Sonny. Similarly, Beth, to what Sonny was saying about the dressing room, can you just tell us about, and also it links to struggle in many ways, what impact it had on the women in Tottenham's team about last season, how it brought you together. Can you give us a sense of that?
Yeah, I mean, it was a tough year. I think anyone watching could see that. I think on and off the field, I think a lot of people were struggling to come to terms with the season that we were having, the results that we were having. There was not much change, and I must credit, because, I mean, there was games where I think there was probably 6 or 7 fans in that stadium. They were loud, they were cheering no matter what, and I could not credit them enough for showing up every game and being there, especially like the proud Lily Whites, because that we could hear them, and I really appreciate that. And I think it's important to recognise that, because without you guys, we would not have been able to get through the season that we did. And I think as results came and didn't come as what we wanted them to be, you could just tell that the morale was so low within the team. And that can be very difficult to get a big group of people, especially women, to kind of like bring that up a little bit again. And we found a turning point in the season, and we managed to get a couple of results which got us on our way. And I think it was just basically making sure that no matter what happened last year, we did not go down. We fought tooth and nail to make sure that we did not go down, because this is an amazing football club. It's a huge football club, and we do not deserve to be anywhere near the championship, because we should be fighting for titles. And hopefully this year we're going to prove that we can do that. And I think for us as players, as athletes, as women, we just wanted to make sure that we were giving everything every day. And I want players to be able to look at each other in the eye and know, I will run through a brick wall for you, because if you don't trust your teammate, then that's all, you're already struggling within the dressing room. And I want the morale and everyone in that dressing room to be able to look at each other and say, no matter what happens today, I will go to war for you and we will get that result. And luckily, by the end of the season, everyone, whether that was players, staff, fans, everyone just gave so much in that last, it was probably a 6-week turnaround, I would say, that we just gave everything that we could, and we managed to stay afloat. And yeah, I'm hoping and praying, and I know, especially having Robert on board, that that won't happen again.
Wow, amazing, amazing. Wow. I'm like, oh, this is amazing. I want to run through a brick wall now, just after hearing that. Daniel, you know, you mentioned last season and just, you know, how difficult it was for you to see what was happening. Let's go to this season. I was talking to a mate of mine the other day, and he said, the atmosphere now at this ground, he said, is unbelievable, right? Just tell us then, equally, the bad times, but now, how that makes you feel when you hear the fans and the joy and the football that's being played.
Simple, we've got our Tottenham back. That's I just feel that, you know, we're seeing football that we used to see, and that's all we want. We want the players to give everything, to play that attacking style of football. We want the fans to have the connection with the players and the staff to have the connection with the players. And you feel it throughout the club. At the stadium, on non-match days, at the training centre, we're together again. It's so noticeable.
Yes, absolutely. Ange, now, obviously, you manage Celtic, so you're probably not aware of big footballing rivalries, but there's a big one coming up this weekend. And of course, I'm being flippant, but this weekend, Tottenham versus that lot from Woolwich.
Look, well aware of, obviously, the rivalry, and you do take that into account, because it means so much to the supporters. As you said, being Celtic manager for a couple of years, there really was only sort of one result that the supporters were really interested in, and you get that sense pretty much every time I open my door. I could tell whether the Amazon guy was a Rangers or Celtic supporter, depending on how he delivered the package. You know, he either threw it at me or he wanted a selfie. So you kind of you understand that, and I love that. You know, that's the beauty of the game. It's the passion that it brings out, because people, you know, feel like their football club is an extension of their family, and you know, they want to protect that, and you know, they want to make sure that you know, every week when we go into battle, that, you know, we come out victors, particularly against our rivals. So we know it's a big game. It's a great test for us as a group. You know, it's particularly away from home. We've already had some decent challenges away from home, but excited by it, looking forward to it. You know, that's why we do what we do. We want to be involved in the big games. We want to overcome the challenges before us, and you know, we'll go in there and play our football, and we'll see where that takes us.
What's the greatest joy you derive from being a football manager?
For me, it's just seeing how it affects people. You know, I mean, yeah, you look at, you know, just the weekend, and forget what was happening on the field. You look in the stands, and I'm sure people were hugging people they'd never seen before in their life, you know. And I love...
It was at that game, or whatever.
Yeah.
It was at the game?
Yeah.
Wow.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, so I love that football does that. There's very few things in life that just connect people automatically, you know, without even thinking about the person next to you, what what age they are, what gender, where they're from, doesn't matter. You know, we're all part of the same tribe, and football connects, and that's why I love the game. Like I said, for me, it's never been, you know, a job, or I've been pretty blessed, actually, it isn't a job. You know, I've avoided having a job most of my life. I'm doing what I love, and but for me, football's more important than that, because like I said, all my meaningful relationships, I have five of my best friends who I've known since the age of seven that I met at my local football club. So football gave me my friends, you know, my connection with my father. I met my wife, she was working for a football club. So everything that's meaningful that's happened in my life has happened through football. So that's where I get the joy. I love all of it, you know, and that doesn't mean it's not, there are times where it's tough, but even then, you know, as Sonny said, you know, that you reflect on those times because you invariably you'll get through them, you know, and it makes you stronger. And, you know, even in those periods of difficulty, you find out just how much closer people become in that time as well, you know, just to help you get out of whatever you are. And that could be your family, your friends, people around you. So, you know, I love the game for what it does to people. It genuinely brings people together, it brings families together, you know, irrespective of whatever week people were having and whatever job they had to go on to Monday, I can guarantee you they went in with a smile on their face because of football, you know.
You've certainly made us smile again, Ange. No doubt about that. No doubt about that. Sonny, any different preparation for the North London Derby, or is it the same? Oh, that's a long pause, isn't it? Wow.
Not yet. Haven't decided yet, so...
Oh, okay. Right. Wow. Yet, so. Wow. Wow. I mean, this is... I mean, you've played a few of these derbies, for instance. You feel a change in atmosphere.
Yeah, it is. It is a special game, obviously, for them as well, but for us as well, because it's a rivalry. It's that you're looking for, obviously, the game results are because... the most important of the probably this of the season. So, yeah, look, I mean, we had a tough years away games away from home. It was tough to take it, but look, winning is never free. You know, winning. You go there, you not get 3 points for free. So I think we wish we can get for free. You know, just go there, get 3 points, and come back. It sounds easy, but. It is never like that. So we have to work hard. So we are working hard on the this week, during the week. So the players are ready. Players are looking forward to it. So look, we are in good moments, and I'm pretty sure they don't want to face us at this moment. And what I can say is I'm guaranteed we are going to give everything. The results, yes. I can't promise you, I can't promise you, but one thing is that I can guarantee I will give everything for this club and especially for Sunday.
And you'll be sad, Sonny. That's why you're the captain. That's why you're the captain. Right, now it's over to you to ask questions. We've got 30 minutes, and like I said at the very beginning, let's keep the questions concise. And I appreciate that many of you would have been supporters for many, many years, and the club definitely appreciates that and that loyalty. But if we can get through as many questions as possible, that would be great. So I think it's a show of hands and then a microphone goes round. And yes, of course, hands have gone up straight away. Person at the front right here, if we can get a microphone. Oh, there you go, lights on. That makes it much better, doesn't it?
Question for Daniel. Given what happened last time, if the European Super League came along again, would you consider it? And also, is there a buyback clause with Bayern for Harry?
yes, there you go. Two questions. A bit cheeky, but there you go.
Well, firstly, under the new rules with the Premier League, we can't consider leaving the Premier League without their consent and the FA's consent. But all I would say to you is that we will always act in the best interest of this club. And I stand by the decision that we made, that we were prepared to have a conversation regarding the European Super League. It was not leaving the Premier League. It was about forming a new European League that would have continued at the same time as the Premier League. But, you know, we failed. It was a disaster for lots of reasons. But I stand by my decision that I was acting in the best interest of the club.
And buyback clause?
Of course.
Okay, good. Good to know. Right. Okay, from this side, where I'll get to... just over the back there. Yes, you with the... No, yeah, there you go. Yeah, keep your hand up. So, there you go. Perfect. Thank you. With the ponytail. Thank you.
Thank you for this opportunity, and welcome to Ange and Robert. And congratulations, Bethany, on the England campaign as well. I'm not sure who this will be specifically directed to, but obviously we really want a trophy. That goes without saying. I think previously in other campaigns, it seems like...
Question, come on, question.
We put it to as a second tournament to go with. What do we need to do? What does the club need to do to support Ange to give him a proper cup run?
Right, I think that's definitely a Daniel question. Daniel, what does the club need to do to... Thank you for your question as well, thank you. What does the club need to support
Ange? We need
Ange?
To provide all the conditions, whether that be appropriate players, facilities, the fans need to get behind the team. We need to all be one, and that gives you the best chance of winning. But I think it's, you know, Ange has won things at other clubs, so maybe it's a question also for Ange. What does he think we need to do?
Yeah, no, and I appreciate the question, and I understand, you know, when a club hasn't had success for a long time, in terms of winning a trophy, how much of a need there is for that. But my view on that is, the best teams, what they do is dominate games of football on a consistent basis, and that's what I want to create. I want to create a team that we dominate every team in the competition, and that will give us a chance of success in any competition. I'm not interested in just winning a cup just for the sake of winning a cup. That's not why I'm here. It's not why I've been at any club I've been at. And to be fair, a lot of the clubs that I've been at didn't have success for a long time. For me, it's about playing away and being a football club, like I said, that dominates against every team. That's what the best teams do, and we want to be one of the best teams. And if we get to that space, then we have an opportunity to win every competition, not just a cup competition. This is not a cup-winning club. This is a club that should be contesting all competitions. That's why I'm here. That's all I'm interested in. So...
questions that I got from people when they applied. Keith Gilbert, where's Keith? Keith, you had a question for Robert. Can we get a microphone to Keith? No. We won't ask you to do that. You could do that at the ground.
Yeah, I'm a grandfather of lots of grandchildren, and some of them are girls. They'd like to come to this wonderful stadium that Mr. Levy has built on our behalf, and they'd like to see the girls playing. Could you please tell me when it will be possible for them to come here regularly to watch the women? Thank you.
All right. Very good question.
Very good question. I think what we're going to do with this women's team is we're going to make sure we develop every week now, and we're going to make sure we get more games on this stadium, but we're also going to make sure we have good performance and, you know, everything around these games. We cannot have like all the games the first year here, because then perhaps we don't bring the people here. So we're going to make sure the biggest games is there first, so we have a good product that we show you. And then hopefully, Daniel, we're going to add those games to be all of the games in the long end. But it's like when you're going to build something up, you need to make sure you have a good atmosphere so that the fans will come, right? So we're going to make sure we have at least 3 or 4 games, then you need to correct me here, this year. So we're going to develop it. We already have one friendly game here.
But the support is here, and they'll come and watch you. If, I think someone once said, if you build it.
Yeah.
He's built it.
So he built it, and now I'm going to make sure we build a team that play that kind of football where everybody will come and watch this game. So I love that you want to bring your grandchildren. Thank you for that.
There you go.
Love that. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you. Yes. In the yeah, you. Yeah, yeah, you. That's right.
So I wanted to make it a little bit lighthearted. So my question is for Sunny. This week is London Fashion Week. And I know, as well as football, I know how much you love fashion. So I've got a bit of a dilemma for you. So if you had to choose, would you choose to have all the designer outfits in the world but never play football again? Or win the Champions League final but only ever wear one outfit for the rest of your life?
Wow. What a question. Wow.
Ah, it's an easy question. One outfit and win the Champions League is...
But thank you for the question. Thank you for the question.
It's an easy Over question. Thank side. You.
Sorry, Sonny, go on.
No, it was an easy question for me to answer, so... Yes.
A harder question would have been, Sonny, are you ever going to learn to dance?
Oh, no, no, please, don't do it. Don't embarrass me here, please, in the stage, so... Please don't do it.
Let's have a look. Yes. We need a microphone first. My apology, I'll go to the back next, so... There we go.
Welcome to the club, by the way, and congratulations. On Saturday at half-time, did you discuss the time-wasting by Sheffield United?
Yeah, I did, and we spoke about it before the game, and I just thought it was really important that we stayed really disciplined and not get frustrated by it, because it was quite obvious, sort of what their kind of tactics were going to be, and it's fair enough, you know, they're fighting for points, they're fighting to stay in the Premier League, and you've got to respect that. The message to the players was pretty similar. Just, you know, really stay disciplined and clear-headed about, you know, because the thing is, the worst thing that can happen is, you know, they were going down and they were sort of remonstrating with the referee a lot, and if we started doing the same, then it would just add more time. And, you know, in the end, I think it worked against Sheffield United because of the 12 minutes. And, you know, for us, you know, as Sonny says, we work hard. We are, I think, the fittest team in the competition, so... If they want to waste time and play an extra 30, we're ready to go, so no issue.
Yes. Right, over the back. You waving it with your thumb up. There you go.
Hi there, thank you. First of all, I'm going to say congratulations to Beth and everything you've achieved with the Lionesses. Played more minutes in a World Cup final than Jimmy Greaves. And also, you've joined such Spurs legends as the great Ozzie Ardiles and Gudney Bergson in earning a law degree. So congratulations on that.
Strong knowledge.
A quick question for Mr. Levy. How much is too much to pay to watch Tottenham Hotspur? And can you give me a number and don't say it depends?
Well, But of course... Questions like that, when you put questions like that, I interview a lot of politicians, that is completely taking out any nuance by you saying that. And there is always nuance, always. But please, Daniel.
Look, we're all very conscious of the cost of coming to a football game. As I said before, we're going to go through a complete review of all our ticketing policies. But, you know, we're in the real world and, you know, the cost of operating a football club has gone up significantly. We're all facing difficult times, and we have tried to restrict the increases for fans, and we will continue to do that.
Okay, let's go to this side. Black jumper.
Hi. For Daniel and Ange, the role of the academy, what do you see the role of the academy is? I mean, there's some clubs that use it as a separate business. Are we going to use it to filter team players into the first team? And if that's the case, is the structure conducive for that?
Well, one of the reasons why we asked Ange to become our manager is that he believes in the academy. The relationship between the first team and the academy is really important. This is a club where we as fans get great thrill out of seeing a player coming from our academy into our first team. And we want to see that flourish. And I think that, you know, over the coming years, we've got some very good young players in our academy. You'll see them come into the first team.
Ange?
Yeah, no, I do. I think it's really important. Firstly, because the club invests so much money in it. You know, it would be a waste of resources if you ignored, you know, what's a big part of the club's investment. If you come down to the training centre, you see the facilities that our young players, you know, train at. And like I said, it's a massive investment. So there needs to be a connection. There needs to be, I think, you know, in life in general, the one thing you need to afford young people is opportunity, and they need to see themselves, you know, one day playing for the first team. And I think there's a connection between, you know, a player who's grown up at a football club. I mean, you know, probably one of the reasons that Harry's, apart from the fact he was a fantastic footballer, he's one of our own here in terms of the club. And I think there's always that connection when they see a player who ostensibly grows up from the stands, it ends up on the field, they see themselves there. So it is important, but it's not an easy process. And like I said, you know, we've got Simon Davis, who's now head of the academy, and, you know, we're working closely together with all the coaches, and we have a lot of the young players coming across and training with the first team. And, you know, for us, as a football club, I think, like I said, when you invest so much in one part of the business, you need to get a return, and part of that is that I think you get a return both in a financial sense, but more importantly, in a connection with, you know, what the football club's about.
We're on this side. Let's go to the front. Young man there. Yes. If we can keep your hand up, my friend, then we can get the mic to you. There we go.
It's for Daniel and Big Ange. So hopefully we're going to be getting Champions League football this year for next season. So we're going to play in bigger clubs than, you know, like Burnley, United, whatever, like, how are you going
to... United?
how are you going to, you know, consistently play this good football? And like, how are you going to work together to do that?
And?
Yeah. Look, absolutely. I mean, I've sort of said consistently, we've started really well in terms of, you know, the way the lads have embraced the football we want to play and you know, just their ability to then put it into practice, what we've been talking about, but we're still very much at the beginning of what we're trying to build. You know, even in terms of, you know, the squad we have at the moment, you know, we had a really positive transfer window in that you can see all the players we've brought in are already contributing, and that's what you want out of it. But, you know, we need to keep building the squad, and it was never going to happen in one window. You know, for me, it wasn't just about bringing in any kind of player. We obviously had more targets in this window, but, you know, I kind of made it easy and difficult for Daniel because I had very few that I wanted in. And so, which made it easy for him, but then difficult if we couldn't get them because I wasn't giving another three options because I just don't want anyone coming in. It's really got to be specific. And, you know, I felt it was a really positive window, and then that gives us the opportunity now to you know, continue to build, hopefully, in the coming windows for what's ahead. Because, like you said, we want to be playing European football. We want to be in the Champions League. And to do that, we've already seen with other clubs that you need a strong squad. You know, you get injuries, you have midweek games. And we'd be playing Champions League tonight or tomorrow night. And, you know, with the squad we have at the moment, we probably wouldn't be able to cope with it. That's the reality of it. So, but, you know, that was always part of the plan. You know, we're going to build, and in terms of the way we play, we're not changing, mate. Doesn't matter who we're playing. You know, we'll go at them and scare the life out of them.
I just want to... where's Sandip from Proud Lily Whites? Sandip in? Where have we got Sandip here? Right, Sandip, what question would you like to ask Beth?
So the Proud Lily White members express great pride in how the club supports its LGBTQ fans, as exemplified by the display of our flag at the Tottenham Hotspur Stadium and our player flags at Brisbane Road. So our question to you is, how do the players and management feel about the club's continued support for the LGBTQ plus community and its efforts to foster a more inclusive Spurs community, both on and off the pitch?
Wow. And thank you for your dissertation. yeah, that was, that's it. But a very, very important question, Beth.
So for me, obviously, being a very proud gay person, I think it's important to be at a club where you feel firstly respected and inclusive. I think I know, obviously, there can be a lot of issues surrounding the LGBTQ plus community. And we obviously notice the flag. We notice that you're there shouting every game. So we appreciate that. And we appreciate the support that you're giving the club. I'm very aware that the club has good interaction with the Proud Lily Whites to make sure that everyone is on the same page and that we're doing everything we can to make sure that everyone feels as safe and as inclusive as possible at this football club, because there's no discrimination here in any forms, whether that be LGBTQ+, racial, disability, anything. That we don't want any discrimination at all. So for me, I think it's important that working with this football club, I know that they've put procedures in place to stamp any of that out, and I feel very much a part of this family and included for just being the person that I am today, and hope that any staff member, player, whoever works within the community of this football club and fans all feel the same love and support that I do from this football club.
Right. Yes, just on the aisle there with your hand up, I think, did you have a hoodie on? There you go, perfect.
Hi, question for Ange and Daniel. Can you give us an insight into the last few days of the transfer window from a chairman and manager's perspective, please?
The last transfer window?
Just the last few days of the transfer window, what it's like from a chairman and manager's
perspective. What it's like?
Yeah.
Okay.
Relaxed, quiet.
Chilly out. Stressful. Very stressful.
Yeah.
And you know, it's you kind of, you hope things fall into place, but you realise that they may not. There was a lot of moving parts there. And, you know, for me, I guess the most important thing was that, you know, we got young Brennan Johnson in, which was really important, I thought, for us. As I said, we kind of had more targets, but they just didn't seem like they were going to happen. But yeah, you know, Brennan was one I was really keen on, because I just think he had, you know, he was the right profile, young guy, was going to fit really well with the dressing room, the way we want to play. So, you know, I kind of left Daniel to do his thing. He didn't need me on the phone every 5 minutes. I was just asking everyone else around him what was going on, just to make him aware. But and then there's also, you know, players going out, and you know, even that's, you know, it's not an easy situation, because those players are potentially training in the morning and maybe out in the afternoon. So it is a challenging time. But I felt, for everything that happened, obviously Harry leaving late in the piece as well, I thought as a group, the players and the club in general, I thought we handled it really well, because it could have really turned into something that looked fairly chaotic, and even though there was a lot of talk around the place, within the building itself, it was, you know, I was really happy with the way everyone dealt with it. I thought everyone sort of kind of understood where we were at, and you know, you get to the end of it, obviously it's a lot more stressful for Daniel and me. We had a game to prepare for, and I was kind of focusing on that. But you know, when I sort of, in the cold light of day, when I looked at our whole window and what we were trying to do, for the most part, it ended up in the positive side for us, I think.
Daniel, can I personally thank you for making sure James Maddison came to Tottenham Hotspur? Thanks for that, getting over the line. Do you want to add anything to what Andrew just said about that last few days?
James needs to learn that he can't come to train again in a red car. I've told him.
Good.
He'll learn.
He'll learn. Yeah. There was at the back in the white. Do you want to stand up just so we can see? There you go. There you go.
Hi. This is a question for Sonny and Beth. Because first of all, congratulations for taking on the role as a captain. You've been reporting things have been mostly positive, and you know, players and team are working together to make everything smooth. But my question for each of you is, what's the biggest challenge for you so far as the captain of the team? Thank you.
Question. Sonny, the biggest challenge as captain so far?
I'd
every day is a big challenge. Every day is a big challenge dealing with dirty kids. No, I'm joking. look, I mean, there's nothing a big challenge because the players are professional enough and they're working hard. So what I said before, I think as a captain, I just want to be a good example, and they're following in the in a really good way, so making my captain job really easy. So, which is, if you have a good people, if you have a good people, good players around me, around the captain, is the job make it easy. So, obviously, I will definitely face.
Not easy.
Yeah, still I'll say easy.
Okay, so, okay, right, good.
But definitely, I will face some big challenge. But obviously, then player or. The gaffer or the club will always be staying behind me. Most importantly, you guys staying always behind me. So then I've nothing to scared about. So just moving forwards, don't look back, and just going forwards with the team.
We're behind you, Sonny. Where's Esme Williams? Esme, are you here? Esme. The question to Esme, and that's for Robert.
Hiya. So, how, as a manager, how do you keep the team focused, like during half time when you're losing, and even just throughout the game? Because as I'm an aspiring manager myself, I want a better insight into that.
Amazing.
Thank you.
Great question, Esme.
Yeah, it's a great question. I think, like Sonia, you tell, like you lead by how you are, and I think I need to be very calm to make sure that the feelings go away when you enter the halftime afterwards. It's more like starting to analyze stuff when you're stressed or frustrated, then you don't really take the right choices. So I'm really trying to be really calm and make sure that everybody get calm, and then we discuss stuff like clearly without feelings. So I think that's one of my best things I have, actually, to make sure everybody's calm, and then hopefully Beth and you guys will be sharp in halftime to make sure we find some solutions. But you know, calm everybody down so we can take the right choices. You don't take the right choices when you're stressed.
How calm is he, Beth?
Quite chill, yeah. Really? Very chill, yeah. I've obviously not spent as much time with him as I'd like, being injured at the minute, but yeah, I've heard very good things, and like I could not agree more. I think in a stressful environment, the heat of the emotions, you don't always think as clearly. And I think on top of that, ultimately, we're all professionals and we all have that drive within us to want to win. So regardless if we are down, there shouldn't be any motivation needed in that dressing room, because I expect everyone in my team to be wanting to go out there and do better in the next half.
Love that, love that. Right, who do we have? Oh gosh, there's so many to choose from. Let's go with purple hoodie and Spurs baseball cap. God, you are representing. Wow.
You got to come prepared.
Yeah, really do.
So this question is for Ange. You mentioned being very specific about transfer targets. How has data influenced finding those targets in the summer transfer window?
How has
data? Data. Yeah, the use of data.
Yeah, sorry.
Thank you.
Yeah, hugely important. As I said, you know, the world's ever changing, particularly in that space. Yeah, fair to say I went through school with a paper and pen, mate, and so it's not my field of expertise. So we employ, you know, a lot of people in that space, like most clubs now, where there pretty much isn't any sort of hidden gems everywhere, you know, anywhere. Every club knows every talented player out there. What becomes important is, you know, how you use that data and what you're using it for, and I still feel it comes down to having a clear idea about what you want, so that then, you know, the data that's only relevant to you becomes important, because like I said, there is so much out there, and it's an ever expanding sort of space, and you know, I think all the top clubs now understand that it becomes an important part of identification, but I still think the most important bit is having a clear idea at the beginning about what you're looking for. And yeah, for us, that means that I need to see them, you know, in our team playing our football, so that when we're talking about, because there's so many fantastic footballers, and sometimes there's very little between choosing any of them, and it comes down to their fit in terms of the way we want to play. Sometimes it comes down to the kind of person they are more than the football qualities, and So that final bit goes beyond the data, but certainly, you know, every football club now understands that, you know, that is your starting point. That, you know, you use the data hopefully in the right way. That instead of looking at a, you know, 500 players, you're looking at maybe 10, 15 that they're going to fit what you're going to do. And like I said, it's ever changing, and there's a lot of smart young people who are working in that space that we're constantly trying to tap into.
Just down the front here.
Question for Sonny.
Just wait till the mic gets you, please.
A question for Sonny. Against Sheffield United, the way you showed your humanity towards Richarlison at the end, how did you preempt pushing him if that had happened? With his mental health, the way he pushed Richarlison towards the fans at
right,
the end.
Yes, right, okay. The question is, did you think so? Yes, the way you treated Richarlison at the end of the game, is that something you thought about before?
No.
Right, and it just...
No, obviously, I'm not preparing anything about it because we heard about Richie's interviews. Obviously, it's not that. Obviously, it's really sad about him. And obviously, as a teammate, I want to help him. And obviously, he saved us in a big moment, which is he showed his quality that shows every training session, which is it's normal. I just feel like he just deserved it to credit. And I think any other players would do the same thing. So we are glad that having him, we are so happy that he scored for us and make an amazing impact in a difficult game. And I think that shows his character. He's strong enough to move forward and move another big steps. And I think it was that day is that Richie's special day and saving us. Yeah, that day was Richie, but another day could be another one, which is will bring us to success. I mean, that day I was more than happy than Richie, so Richie totally deserved it for me, but I didn't prepare anything for Richie, but I think after that game, Richie deserved that credit and that love from the fans.
Mm. Ange, I think off the back of that, Ange, what that says to you as a manager about that spirit, that team, that support for each other, not just footballing, but emotional support for each other.
Yeah, it's important. I mean, when you think about it, you know, the lads in the dressing room, they probably spend more time together than they do with their families, you know, on a daily basis. So that there is a connection there between them. And they also all understand that, you know, in their own lives, they've all got, you know, I spoke about it before the game, that they've all got, you know, challenges, whatever that may be, because they're human beings. You know, being a professional footballer doesn't mean you're immune from that. So, you know, they feel for their teammates. But ultimately, I think what Sonny's trying to say was that day was about Richie and his football. You know, he came on and made a difference, mate. He scored, he assisted, he was, you know, he helped his teammates and his football club to victory. That's what that was about. You know, and beyond that, the support he needs, or all the players need, you know, the football club's there for them, you know, and like I said, it's more, you know, for Richie to understand that, and for all footballers, I guess that was my sort of main sort of message, was that, you know, sometimes you think as a footballer you've got the perfect life. Well, the perfect life doesn't exist for anybody. We all have challenges, and, you know, but what football hopefully provides them is, you know, a foundation where they can feel comfortable that can hopefully help them in all these other areas of life.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, we have sadly run out of time. My apologies. Can we?
In front.
Oh,
yeah,
is it? Oh.
He's got the best question. Come on.
I didn't see that.
Come on.
Sorry, my apologies.
That's all right. Your question. I saw you. There
what
you go.
What is your
Come
question?
On, I knew it was for me. So
well spotted, Ange. Thank you.
Ash, perfect whole season.
Sorry?
How much perfect season you like every football club? How much are we going to win? How much the team?
Okay. Thank you for that question as well.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Good man.
We'll do our best. Everybody involved in the football club, my side, Robert's side, Beth and Sonny. I think we've all said tonight we understand what it means to all you, to all you folk about, you know, this football club, what it means to you, and our role is to try and make you happy and proud every time we go out there. So that's what we'll try and do.
Now, if you are lucky enough to have a gold wristband, Stacey and Joe are over there from the membership team. Please, they're just waving at you now. So if you're one of those gold wristbands, and go over and see them afterwards. We're not leaving just this second. Now, what we are going to do, though, is we're going to just take... Is that OK? We can take a quick selfie with everyone here in the background. Is that cool? We can do that? Right, you've got the longest arms, I think, Sonny. So, right, OK, you're gonna do this. Can we all just stand up and just... Bethany, I really don't want you to fall off the edge there. That would be worth a lot of money to this club, and I'll get sued. So... Let's do this. Don't worry. I'm not going to be in the selfie, so you guys are going to have to. You've got the longest arms there. There you go. You will do this. Sorry, Daniel. Right. Okay. Right. And everyone's going to put their hands up in the air. Everyone's going to, because you're all in this selfie. You're all in this selfie. Can we get this done? Can we get that done? Is it good? Yeah. Is everyone in? Yeah. Get your arms up. Yeah. Get your arms up. Come on. Get in. Yeah. Right. Okay. Right.
You're getting
a phone
call.
Okay. Sorry. Let's go marching in. Oh, when the Spurs go marching in. Oh, we'll be in that number. Oh, when the Spurs go marching in. Oh, when the Spurs go marching in. Oh, what an amazing selfie. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like you to put your hands together and make a lot of noise, but just keep doing it, because round of applause for the captain of the women's team, Bethany England. Yes, the manager of the women's team, Robert Vilahamn. The chairman of Tottenham Hotspur, Daniel Levy. The manager of Tottenham Hotspur's men's team, Ange. And the captain of the men's team, Solly. Have a safe trip home. Thank you for coming and making this a fantastic evening. Thank you to all of you for this. Brilliant. Thank you.